So good morning, one and all. First of all, let me thank TQIP for organizing this and sponsoring this particular event, and the organizers like Professor Jha, then Dr. Tiwari, and so many other people involved from Shimla. So I also thank them. As you know that I have kept my talk topic on trends in energy harvesting for wearable devices. So as Dr. Tiwari said, I worked in wearable computing domain, and work has been cited by so many researchers. Basically, my main PhD was focused on automotive driver stress recognition. So I had inspiration I had taken from one of the work at MIT USA. Now my paper, they have cited twice. My paper has been cited twice in ACM Computing Survey. So little bit of marketing also I am doing, because one should know in which area we are working. So my work is getting recognized around the world. But further, due to lack of funding and so many transitional issues, the work has not been progressing. And now I have diversified in several other areas like smart agriculture, then VLSI, and some intelligent chips. I have some PhD students. So that is what I have, other than what Professor Tiwari told. Now, in the energy harvesting area, the theme was energy for a particular event. So I also tried to connect it. Basically, I work in the data collection and analysis part in wearable domain. And you will be, just to inform all of you, that I had collected primary data from automotive drivers in Pilani, and then we had analyzed, and that work is open for now. So it is in public domain. Now, in the case of wearable devices, what I am going to talk about is this. So because many of you might be knowing what is wearable, and since the audience is diverse, I thought let us give an introduction to wearable computing as well as devices, its applications and challenges that we are facing. Challenges in a way, I will focus more on human-powered computing. There are several other areas. So here, human-powered computing relates to energy harvesting itself. And in the next phase of my discussion, a little bit of discussion, how we can save power on the node. That means on a wearable computer, how we can save the power on the node. So a little bit of that, I will try to delve into it. And then I have two case studies that depends upon time. If time permits, I will explain. Otherwise, I will just discuss a little bit about in those case studies what was achieved. Okay. Finally, I will try to conclude. Now, when we talk about wearable computing, what is known as wearable computing? So the first part of my talk starts from here. This is the definition given by Steve Mann, who at MIT had given this definition during 1997. So if you see the definition given by him, variables as constant and always ready, unrestricted, not monopolizing of user attention, observable and controllable by the user, attentive to the environment, useful as a communication tool, and personal. So meaning of this one is, when I have a wearable computer, that is nothing but a personal device, which is personal to me, and it will be always ready. And whenever I want to use it, I can use it unrestrictively, and I am not getting diverted due to so many other work which I am doing, right? So it will be working independently even though I am wearing it. So this is one important characteristic feature of wearable computer. This device will have another, you can say, characteristics of observable and controllable. So even though I am not be using it permanently, even though I am wearing it, I am not controlling it permanently, but it can be observable and relating to the context in which I am working. So when I discuss the applications, you will come to know what is that. So it should be attentive to the environment. That means in the context of a particular environment, it should be active. It should be always available. I can use this as a communication tool also. So this definition was given by Steve Mann. So if some of you might be knowing, maybe computer science students might be knowing, he is in the variable computing, and his contribution to the variable computing is well known. So as you can see, he's wearing a variable computer, started since 80s. Then in mid 80s, one prototype he is handling. Then in early 90s, so this picture indicates that the evolution of variable domain, who is a professor of textile engineering at Georgia Tech. In 2001, he, along with his PhD student, had designed one prototype known as the variable motherboard. And this was considered the one of the most and promising invention of the century, right? This has been designated as this. So in which vital sign monitoring sensors are there along with processing elements, so that the vital sign of anybody, those who want to monitor their health status, could be monitored as well as recognized. Then you can see here Muthaiah Muralidharan is getting examined by a biomechanics. So on his body, there are several sensor dots. Why this was there, I brought this example because of certain reason. If you know, there was one chucking issue with Harbhajan Singh and Muthaiah Muralidharan. So they were sent to Australia, and their biomechanics were involved. They tried to analyze their angle of throw, how they were throwing. That 15 degree issue was there. So in those kind of situations also, this can be used. Besides this, as you can see, a cyclist is there, right? And you will be able to monitoring the cyclist several vital parameters, and the sensors might be available on the helmet, like on the shoes. Then smart socks may be there, and similarly so many other things like gloves and a shirt. So this is just one example. There are several examples. This is for navigation. In this case, one blind person is there. He is having one camera which is enlarged and on, right? So using this camera and the object that is in front of him, the person is, that means the blind person is intimated with the help of a variable computer, that how far that person is there and in which direction he has to go, right? And he has several other support, like a refreshable braille display, then haptic vibration belt, etc. is there. Suppose he is not able to maneuver properly, right? Then one alarm could be generated. So based on that, these kind of alert is possible. Similarly, in construction work also, we can have variable computers. As you can see, a construction worker is using a headgear along with several other devices, right, which could be used, and then that is going to help them in several construction activities. Similarly, so for example, pest control or detection of certain kind of elements in plant. So a farmer can use a variable computer. So with the help of RFID tags, he will be able to identify the particular place where he has to spray. So deduce a spray preparation from a series of detected RFID tags, and he will be capturing and storing what he is able to watch, right? Monitor carefully how a farmer moves his arm also. So this is depicted here in this form. Likewise, you have several other applications. So this is for social interactions. As you can see, this has been already proved that Google Glass, which was designed, could be used for social interactions. Here, a nurse or a medical personnel is using this to interact with the patient, and even the patient's vital sign parameters could be underground mining. This will be very much helpful, where we can have variable gears to the miners, given to the miners, and they will be able to identify certain dangerous gases and so many other things with the help of sensors, right? So in those kind of situations, it could be used. And this, everybody is familiar, the new generation is familiar about these kind of devices in the form of fitness band. as well as the smartwatches, it's available. This is actually capturing the market. So if I say that in market, what is available, this is available in the form of certain kind of smartwatches, then so many other fitness bands, etc. Now, as I told, in advanced robotics can be used, and this is going to be the future. It has been predicted that in advanced robotics, this will help us in big way. For example, three categories are shown: exoskeletons, soft wearable robots, and bionic body. Right. So, exoskeletons. Some areas are mentioned here, like it may be used for heavy lifting. Then walking assistance if somebody is paralyzed, right? Then also it will help. Then there are certain stretchable materials using which soft wearable robots could be designed that also helps in certain kind of movement assistance, rehabilitation, and injury prevention. Similarly, you have bionic body. So bionic arm, artificial heart, and body prosthetic that are being used nowadays, where a proper control of muscle could be provided with the help of bionic body or bionic prosthetic. So these are certain application areas. Now, the challenges that we may face in wearable computers is, these are very small devices and that are worn on our body. So as usual, like in mobile devices, we are having several constraints. In a similar way for wearable computers also, resource constraints will be always there. So small form factor requirement is one key requirement that we need to address. Then traditional computing requirements will not match in this case, because here the CPU requirement will be different. So its speed requirement will be different, memory will be different, as well as the network bandwidth, connectivity options. Everything will be not exactly same as we use in normal day-to-day life with the mobile devices, etc. That's where the difference lies. Okay, then comes the energy sources, because with the size of the battery, the bulkiness of the device increases. Now, how to solve this issue? So if we increase battery size, the bulkiness of device will also increase, and if we have to wear it for 24 hours, it is not going to be accepted by the users. Right. So like this, wearable challenges will also come into picture, because bulkiness will again hinder the operation of a particular device, as well as human, you can say, attention will be diverted. So connected to this, there are several other challenges. For example, let us discuss about the battery life. As we know, that battery life improvement nowadays is not keeping up with the required power need, right? One example is given here, just to correlate, like three versions of iPhone is mentioned here: iPhone 11, then iPhone Pro, and then iPhone 11 Pro Max. Okay, so the battery weight is given here. Weight is 194 for 11, whereas the battery weight is 47. So about 24.23% of it is occupied by the battery, right? As well as the space. Right, so it is, as we increase the battery size, right, battery weight, so here it is in the case of 11 Pro, 48 grams, okay, out of total 188. Similarly for 11 Pro Max, 65 grams out of 226. Okay, so this is going to occupy more space on our device. Now consider or correlate this with the wearable computer. If we are using battery, again the same issue will be cropping up. So how to tackle this? That means we need to tap something in such a way, I mean the energy in such a way, that we are going to minimize the use of battery, but we need to find some alternate means, right? So that's what we are going to discuss. So we will discuss as we know that resource aware computing, if we talk about, that means for smaller devices, we are talking technologies that make computation choices based on available resources. So we need to think into that direction, right? How we provide the wireless communication, whether we are using scheduling, batching, etc. Then display brightness adaptation. As you would have seen in mobile phones, automatically whenever we enter into darker place, the display brightness changes, like this kind of adaptation in our design should be there, right? So this computation is one important requirement, even in the case of wearable computers also. Mostly people don't use displays, but this display is available in other form, mostly haptic display, some kind of sensors. So dynamic frequency scaling is one technique which is used to minimize the power consumption. Gathering power from ambient sources to extend or recharge battery life. So this is where we are going to talk. We can tap power from solar energy, then RF harvesting, thermal harvesting, piezoelectric harvesting, and kinetic harvesting. Further to this, efficient computing due to constrained resources, what are the solutions? People thought of whether we can offload the computation to a remote server. So normally, for longer duration, there are several types of data that we are collecting using wearable computers. If the data could not be analyzed on the wearable computer itself because it is either having a large volume or it needs a complex algorithm that may not run on the wearable node, then we need to transfer the data to a server or a remote device where it could be analyzed, right? So computing at the edge is often more power efficient than transfer. Then we have alternate solutions. Can we use like this? So can we choose efficient algorithms so that power consumption is less? There are certain techniques like fixed point algebra, then compress the data to be transmitted, batch wireless transmissions, right? These are certain suggestions, but they may not be always feasible, right? So people have tried to address these kind of issues related to power. Basically, power use, if we talk, this is the most limiting factor in any kind of mobile technology. And since wearable computer is also one kind of mobile in nature, so here also it relates. Peripherals, as we know, that wirelessly they are communicating to some mobile devices. So a lot of power sources might fail independently, that will create some issue. Then the system as a whole sometimes unreliable, right? And it will lead to high maintenance cost also. These are the issues that are there with the power use in certain mobile devices, which is even correlating to wearable computers. Then alternative ways to generate power or harvest power has been suggested in literature as human-powered computing. So I will focus on this more. So the recharging of batteries has to be tied to everyday activities. For example, like cleaning, contact lenses or eyeglasses, natural breaks, providing charging time are when we sleep or when we eat, so during meals, or at the beginning and end of the workday, we can have some kind of, you can say, charging time for us, for our device. Recharging should be implicitly coupled with normal acts of dressing. So these are suggestions and demonstrated also through inductive charger hidden in the wearer's bedroom closet. So further to this, we have whether our physical activity can charge the wearable computer. So energy from pressing the keyboard buttons could be tapped to power the keyboard itself. Then as we wear shoes can generate power when the user is walking. This has been demonstrated successfully. Human food will act as a power source, right? Heat dissipation, like our body heat could be used as a power source. So for wearable computer, normally the millions of instructions per second is the parameter that we use to measure the processor speed. But in the case of wearable computer, just MIPS will not work. Here, MIPS per watt is important, okay? So MIPS per watt is more important measure than just MIPS. And these are like we will use low power CPUs and certain components which use or consume less power. Then placing the wearable computer at a place which is exposed to certain kind of airflow on the body, for example, on forearm, and phase change materials, right? So this particular background was needed. A little bit of disturbance happened. I took time to explain this. Basically, what we came to know from this first section of discussion, that energy harvesting is important and we need to find certain alternate sources of energy, right? So let us discuss that part. As we know that energy conversion, if we take a scenario of a wearable health monitoring, right? So patients will be expected to charge the sensors or replace the batteries on a regular basis if it is used for continuous monitoring, right? And frequently we need to charge, and the bulk of the battery can disturb us. It can be frustrating the user, those who are having a wearable computer like patients, okay? So they may not be interested, right? So what solutions people have provided? They provided, like, can we decrease the power? So the size and weight of each sensor node, we can try to decrease it. Thus, we will increase the patient comfort and the wearability of the device so that it is accepted by several users, as well as it could be used in hospital environments. So one of the important goal is designing such type of body sensor nodes, in short it is written BSNs, is to minimize energy consumption while preserving an acceptable quality of service. So how do we do that? For that purpose, we need to understand that battery life is the major concern here, right? So whether we can have something like this, limiting everything from data sensing rates and link bandwidth and weight, so that it improves the energy efficiency, or can we have lower sampling frequency of the data which we want to collect from the wearer, or we can decrease the processing power, or we can simplify the signal processing. So all aspects that are mentioned here have been tried by several research groups, right? And some people even suggest, like, deactivating nodes that are unnecessary for specific tasks that we are anyway watching in our day-to-day lab computer and desktop and laptop computers. Whenever we are not using, it goes into sleep mode. So using those features, even these computers could also be designed. Now, for energy harvesting, if we want to talk on WBSN or wearable body area network, sometimes it is known as WBAN also, WBSN also. So there are two types of communication that are taking place: long distance and short distance. Long distance data transmission will be performed only by using the batteries as a power supply, whereas for short distance, like the sensors with a short distance wireless link, we can power autonomously. That means we can tap the power autonomously on the device itself or from the body, human body. So self-powered micro generators are the solutions which can eliminate the necessity of wiring and batteries in autonomous and standalone devices. Then energy harvester, also known as scavenger, is nothing but a small power generator. And this doesn't require fossil fuel. This uses energy available in the ambient, such as an electromagnetic energy, vibration, wind, water flow, thermal energy, etc. Energy harvester, what we use is typically several to 1 centimeter size power micro plant, which converts into electricity any primary energy which is available in the ambient. And reason to call them harvesters or scavengers is given as based on the application area, because they are used for powering smaller devices such as smaller nodes, sensor nodes or sensors. That's why this name has been given. And as you know, that energy harvester could be combined with battery and serve a complementary source of power to improve energy autonomy of a device at a limited size of the battery. So this is the block diagram of a particular energy harvester. If you can see the pointer, this is typical your power supply, like you have one energy source which could be tapped from light energy, mechanical energy or thermal energy. So this should be converted to the corresponding electrical energy with the help of a harvesting transducer. Sometimes you may need some power management circuit immediately after this conversion is there. So one level of regulation may happen here. Then you will have a storage element. And finally, since after this introduction of capacitor and all the labels will shift. So you need to regulate it further, right? So as you can see, this thick line which is showing, which is shown as the connection between different units, right? So from voltage regulator to sensors, as well as transceivers, as well as to microcontroller unit, this is connected. Whereas the dotted line indicates that a data will be exchanged, like from sensors it will be collected or it will be transmitted to outside world. So that's why this dotted line is shown. So this is a typical scenario for an energy harvester, right? So this thing I have already discussed. So this is just to support this. Now, what kind of devices are available as energy sources? What kind of energy sources these days? The energy harvesting for variables, the trend is we tap the power from ambient as well as some external power, we say, that is nothing but sometimes from human or even ambient also. For example, for RF based energy harvesting, that is being done from external as well as ambient, right? In ambient, we have solar power, then thermoelectric and RF, whereas in external, human power based computing and energy harvesting is being done. So in that also, there are two categories, biochemical and biomechanical, right? And these are the typical power densities that are available from these particular sources, like ambient light, thermoelectric, radio frequency, human, etc. So they are in the order of milliwatt to microwatt for light. So if we tap it from direct sun, it is 100 milliwatt per centimeter square. For indoor illumination, it is 100 microwatt per centimeter square. For thermoelectric, it is in the range of 60 microwatt per centimeter square, and from radio frequency it is available in the range of 15 microwatt. Whereas from human, based on the category of sensing or harvesting that we are doing, we can have 1000 microwatt per centimeter square for biochemical, whereas for biomechanical, 4 microwatt per centimeter cube and 200 microwatt per centimeter cube. So for micro generator and piezo electric devices are available. So advantages and disadvantages I'm skipping as of now. Basically, we are starting with this title is misplaced here. Actually, this title is nothing but your solar cell. Solar. Right? So this photovoltaic cell we use here, and an equivalent circuit of that is given. So this is the photo generated, and this is your shunt resistor as well as the current that is flowing through this. Finally, you get here voltage as your photovoltaic voltage as output. So this is the series resistance, right? Magnitude of electricity generated is directly proportional here in this case to the size of PV cells and level of illumination. During daytime, up to 100 milliwatt per centimeter square of energy can be harvested with conversion efficiency between 15% and 20%. So based on solar power, certain devices have been developed where they are using solar power. For example, in this particular figure, if you can see, they have given the name for this particular band as Soli band because they are using solar power. Here they are using microcrystalline solar cells and with some flexible material it is attached. Okay, so this is the sensor, photoplethysmography sensor, front end of that is shown. Here the system on chip which is taking care of all processing is there, and then since PPG uses transmitter as well as receiver, so photodiode is available on the casing itself. So this particular area is charge management board where power circuitry related things are there. Same circuit is explained here also. So this is the system on chip where an accelerometer is also there. This is the PPG front end, and then the LED photodiode is available. this particular thing indicates a silicon cushion, and then what you can see is lithium polymer battery and super capacitor flexible band unit is available here. And this particular black color is the monocrystalline solar cell. So this is used particularly at wrist, as you can see the wearer is wearing it. So this is your Soli band. In C, a flexible PV cell is used. As you can see, it can be placed like this, as well as near to your palm, it could be placed like this. So at wrist, it could be placed like this. So this use of flexible PV cells is also day by day increasing. But yeah, it requires a lot of work. And here, flexible PV system is shown. So power management electronics is shown at the bottom. And at the top, you have energy storage devices, which is in the form of flexible, what is called electronics. This is your photovoltaic module, which is there. And these are the electronic connections or leads, loads that is being used in the particular case. So this is one example of solar-based energy harvesting. As we can understand from this, this is a source which is free, but it has certain limitations, like controllable and only partially it can be predictable. Magnitude of energy harvested is also influenced by weather patterns and time of the day. And the PV cells are non-linear devices. So they have an optimal operating point, which maximum power output is at which this is generated. Solar energy basically is employed in conjunction with the maximum power point tracking technology to maximize conversion efficiency. Now, as I told you that I am going to focus more on human powered computing. And as you can see from this particular slide, this particular data was published in 1996, so it is not new. As you can see in the right hand side table, there are several activities that we perform, so that human perform, like sleeping, then lying quietly, etc., and how much kilocalorie we burn during this time. What is the power that is spent here, right? So that is shown in watts here. And in the left hand side, different locations are shown, as well as certain activities that we perform. For example, when we exhale, total power is 1 watt, but during the normal exhalation, etc., 0.4. So in the parenthesis, the total power for each action is given. So corresponding to each of the activity, you can find out, like breathing band. So you will have a band here, then you will be able to capture it. If you want to measure the blood pressure, so you will be able to capture here. Similarly, arm motion, finger motion, then footfalls, etc., will give you some idea how much energy we can tap, right? Then body heat, mostly it is going out of our head area, right? So body heat, not only head, but certain changes which has due to the evolution of mankind, certain things have been already settled down, right? So normally, as you can see here, body heat is close to 2.4 to 4.8 watts. So the idea is not new, but how to design devices is a challenging task for the designers. So coming to the biochemical energy harvesting, as you can see in this particular case, in this case, what happens actually when chemical bonds are broken, energy will be released. So to tap the energy or to get the energy or harvest the energy, biofuel cells are being used. So power generated via chemical reactions between anode and the cathode with the help of a catalyst is done. So here the catalyst is used to accelerate this chemical reaction. And what happens in this case is, as you can see, anode and cathode is available here. One example is shown. And the glucose is considered implantable glucose fuel cell is one example is taken here. Here the anode is oxidizing the chemical compound and reduce it to the cathodes. So infinite amount of energy can be harvested And as we discussed, that glucose is going to be the most common chemical substance which is extracted from the body. So using this particular technique, this is being tapped. Then another case is from glucose, there are three types of fuel cells using glucose. So enzymatic glucose cell metabolizes glucose into acid and releases electrons that generate electrical energy up to 100 microwatt per centimeter square. But there are certain limitations, like changes in pH conditions may disrupt or destruct the enzyme structure. Then there is something which is known as microbial glucose fuel cell that uses microorganisms to oxidize the glucose. And this will be giving power up to 1000 microwatt per centimeter square. Here the challenge is how to stabilize the microbe population, because preventing bacteria from escaping the cell is very challenging, and sometimes it may infect the user also. The third type is abiotic glucose fuel cell that oxidizes glucose by using a solid state anode catalyst, and this produces less than 10 microwatt of power per centimeter square. The limitation is catalyst is least efficient amongst various catalysts, but reliable and biocompatible. So this middle one, microbial glucose, although people try it, but it is ruled out for variable applications due to safety issues or infection issues. Besides this, human body fluids like saliva, sweat, etc. can also be used for harvesting of energy from chemical sources from body. So lactate is one example. And in this case, a tattoo which is shown here. So tattoo-based biofuel cell harvests biochemical energy from lactate in the perspiration, which is generated during the activities that a human performs. And the densities we can achieve is 70 microwatt per centimeter square. So this is the amount of energy that will be released during a physical activity. So these two types I have shown, but there are several other, you can say, biochemical energy harvesting devices or fuel cells. Then energy is being tapped by human motion. So mostly we say here as biomechanical energy, and there are three types. So piezoelectric, we have electromagnetic, and triboelectric, right? So in this case, one by one, I will try to include them. So two ways to harvest energy from everyday human activity, passively or actively. Passively means we are not aware, we are just doing our work and we are tapping the energy. Whereas in the case of actively, tapping power will be, we know this and we will be performing certain activity to get the power. So that is what is available. In the passive case, we don't know. Person does not realize that he is doing some extra work. Whereas in the case of active power harvesting, we know that we are doing some extra work to generate the power. So these are certain terms that are used. Now coming to the piezoelectricity, which is the property of a material which generates electricity upon mechanical deformation. And there are two effects. One is known as direct effect, another is direct effect is nothing but conversion of mechanical energy to electrical energy. Whereas in the case of indirect effect, transformation of electrical power to mechanical deformation is taken into account. So as you can see here, this is the relationship that you will get. Capital D is nothing but your displacement. And this is equal to small d sigma plus epsilon E. So epsilon is your permittivity and capital E is the electric field intensity taken from our electrostatics discussions. So for piezoelectric material, Rochelle salt, barium titanate, and quartz are mostly used. They produce electrical power when applied tracer or we apply mechanical force. So using this concept, several devices have been designed. Variable devices have been designed in which energy harvesting people have tried to incorporate, right? So this is indirect effect where the epsilon is representing the strain and sigma is representing the stress. This S is the elastic compliance of that particular material, right? So here one piezoelectric case is there. There are several, you can say, mode. Here it is showing 3-1 mode, and what name, this suffix is based on the axis. Like, for example, in this case, strain is caused to axis one. So this is our axis one. So if we cause strain here by electrical charge applied to axis three, right, then it will be known as 3-1. So likewise, you have several other 3-3 and so many other configurations. Not everything we can take into this lecture because everything is a separate topic to discuss. So this will produce that strain which is getting here due to the energy applied at 3 or charge applied at 3 axis will produce some electrical charge along the axis 3. So you will be getting the voltage difference that you can tap. So this is one way of using piezoelectric energy. But there are several configurations and some examples are shown here. So this is the smart shoe. In this case here, what you can see is this is a force sensor. And then these are aluminum plates on which it is attached. So force sensor installed on aluminum plates are shown here. And within that, it is shown, the same configuration is shown like this. Now, the location of placement of this particular sensor is exactly at your, this red color is shown. So there it will be installed so that when we walk or run based on the force exerted, it will be trying to generate the energy. So that shows the installation location. And in this particular work, they had tried some experiment also. On treadmill, they had taken certain measurements, right? So one scenario or setup of data collection is shown here, right? So this is one example, but you will find several other literature related to piezoelectric energy harvesting based devices, okay? So the advantage is it will power low powered electronic devices, which is variable also in nature. The limitations are ultra low frequency of humans, which is around 1 hertz. So the operating bandwidth of these kind of devices is quite high, which makes human motion unfeasible, right? Chances of wear and tear will be more here. Motion range of human is usually much higher than the predetermined device size. So human motion is a multi-dimensional motion, as you know, like we do so many types of activity, bending, stretching, sliding, etc. So in addition to our linear vibration, these kind of activities we are performing, right? So complex movements we have, how do we tap from this? Like, for example, limb produce complex movements during walking, then making it difficult for linear PEH to extract power from multidimensional motion, right? So that was the piezoelectric case. The second one is in human powered computing is electromagnetic energy harvesting. So this is again using the Faraday's law of magnetic induction, right? So this utilizes relative motion of the coil, which is nothing but a conductor and a magnet, to generate the electricity. So the potential difference that is produced at the both ends of the coil will be tapped here. And when that coil is moved inside a magnetic field, as you know, from Faraday's law, it is going to produce a voltage difference. So in addition, the voltage induced in the coil is proportional to the rate of change of magnetic. These are the formulas that we are familiar, where this phi is nothing but total magnetic flux. And this is rate of change of flux is shown, which is defined here as area of ith coil, this AI, and B is the magnetic field, right? So next, based on this, the first type of harvester is shown in front of you. So this is known as rotational electromagnetic energy harvester, REH, right? This is the structure of REH. I will use the pointer to indicate this particular magnet is your rotor magnet. So this is slightly larger, and whereas this one is a smaller, which is a stator magnet. So both clockwise as well as anti-clockwise movement will happen based on where it is placed, okay? Where this device is attached to our body, clockwise and anti-clockwise movement will happen, right? So with the help of coils as well as some kind of shifting devices, gear mechanism, it works, right? These yellow color things are nothing but your coil, right? And in the figure B, this is attached here at our what is called wrist is shown, and based on each activity, the movement or the motion is shown. So this is anti-clockwise, this one is also anti-clockwise. So when our hand moves, when we are walking, based on that, the movement and the rotation is accordingly shown. Similarly, this one is for running activity, which is shown here. So clockwise and anti-clockwise rotation of REH attached to wrist and ankle is shown in this figure. Physical model of REH is shown. So this you can say side view, and this is top view of that particular device for energy harvesting. You can get maximum output 10.4 milliwatt at driving frequency of 8 hertz and load resistance of 100 ohm. Similarly, we have two more types of energy harvesters which are using electromagnetic energy harvesting. In this particular case, which is at the bottom, which I am showing right now, this is known as your oscillator based energy harvester, where a tube is there, and in that tube, basically this uses mass damper system, and it is working in lower frequency ranges. So a hollow tube is there, within that a mass is there. At the both end we have magnets available, right? At the both end we have magnets available, and mass will move horizontally. So this movement is also shown here. On top, coils, as you can see, are shown here, right? So mass moves horizontally due to repelling of the magnets, and due to that be able to tap the energy. So a model of this is shown again here using 3D printing. The solenoid coil is wrapped around here in this particular case. This is known as oscillator energy harvester. The third type is known as hybrid energy harvester, where actually we use dual, you can say, eccentric rotor, which is here, dual eccentric rotor with magnetic poles, and power output of linear motion is based on the electromagnetic energy harvesting method, and which is low actually in linear cases like here or in the previous case. So this particular issue is resolved by the hybrid mode, right? So in rotational case, what happens, the inertial mass uses eccentric rotor, which is shown here, and due to the coupling of kinetic energy, which is produced by human movement or body motion, we will be able to tap the energy during certain activities like walking, running, stretching, etc. And for this particular case, you will be getting close to 61.3 microwatt at 1 hertz frequency. So these three types are electromagnetic. The third case is triboelectric energy harvesting, which is working slightly differently. But the advantages of this one is more than the other two cases what we studied. It provides high power density, low operating frequency, and high conversion efficiency, lightweight and low cost, and it is nowadays explored more. So what happens in this case, when two materials with dissimilar polarities are making contact with each other, charges will transfer. So charge transfer will take place due to the thermoelectric effect, which results in creation of positive, right, on each side of the surface. So here you can see, this is the case of when the contacts are being made, so pressing, and when they are just removed, so releasing. Based on this cycle, the triboelectric motion generation is working, and we get the energy. So if these materials connect with metal electrodes at the two non-contacting ends, the detachment of surface leads to charge accumulation because of the electrostatic induction effect. So this particular case is known as vertical contact separation mode, because we are doing the contact or making the contact vertically, right? So cyclic contact and separation between two surfaces in order to provide an output electric current is shown in this case. So this is the current for this case when it is being placed. This is the case when it is being released, right? So repeating contact, the two surfaces will result in the charge flow in opposite ends. One example is shown here. What you can see is there are several, for example, this one shows the 3D structure of a textile-based tribo-electric generator, and this is also known as a nano generator. So this particular thing is showing this one, and the placement location are also shown. So corresponding to this, it is placed at the you can say your forearm here, and then this is just above the wrist. Similarly here, close to the wrist. Okay, and this is the activity performed. Like we can use it for energy harvesting in several applications, IoT, healthcare monitoring, as well as robotic control. In this is one kind of polymer mixture, right, which is shown. So known as PE.PSS, right? This is a cotton textile that is being used for the energy harvesting task here. Then scanning electron microscope image is shown in C, which is this. So for this particular fabric. Finally, working mechanism of a smart textile-based triboelectric generators are shown, which is similar to what we had in the previous case. So pressing, releasing cycle will be repeated so that we get the energy depending upon the activities we perform. So some devices are placed here at the foot, some devices are placed at the hand. Okay, so this is how triboelectric energy harvesting is being used. Then comes energy harvesting from human body heat, right? So we coming into the category of warm-blooded animals or homotherms, so including humans as well as some cattle, we are all in the warm-blooded animals. Heat flow can be converted into electricity by using a thermoelectric generator, the heart of which is a thermopile. So the human body, as we know, is not a perfect heat supplier for variable thermoelectric generators, because the body has high thermal resistance. So the heat flow is quite limited, right? So at typical indoor conditions, the heat flow in a person depends on the location on the body, as well as it mainly stays within the 1 to 10 microwatt per centimeter square range. This is the scenario for a thermal generator when we are talking about thermoelectric generators. So body heat we want to use without a particular device, we have the scenario. So ambient, which is shown here, has a high thermal resistance too. So indoors, it can be evaluated by using natural heat convection theory. And the TEG, when it is placed at the interface between the object with high thermal resistance, so the body as well as the air, they will also have high thermal resistance relatively. So using this effect, what we can do is we can correlate this, that it is electrothermal situation where voltage, current, and resistance are replaced here with the help of temperature difference. So this delta T is representing that one. Then heat flow is represented by this W, and thermal resistance are shown here by RHG for the core body core temperature, and for ambient temperature, it is shown as RHS. But when we place the device on body, then the device is acting as the thermal. Okay, so the equivalent circuit is as above. Human being with no device is the first case, and second case is with a TEG on the skin. Human body as a heat generator and the ambient air as a heat sink represent natural thermal generator that is shunted on the skin, right? So at interface between the body and air is shown. If we replace the TEG, if we place the TEG on the skin, right, the device behaves as a thermal load, as I told, like this. So in dotted line here it is. Using this particular analogy or the circuit equivalent diagram, you will have several types of thermoelectric generators. So these are certain explanation of those resistances, right? What I want to mention here is these are the core temperature. For cattle, 39 degrees centigrade. Baby animals, 41 degrees centigrade. Small birds, 38. So in general, if the animal is smaller, the smaller variable TEG is needed. And the ratio RTEG divided by RHG, RHS, and RTEG will determine the part of available temperature difference to be obtained on the. So there are certain other equations that you can go through if I share the slide if you want. So this is the structure of a thermoelectric generator, where what you can see is a thermopile between the hot and cold plates of thermoelectric generator is placed. Okay, so here A is representing the cross section of variable thermoelectric generator. B, in the B figure, you have a thin TEG on the human skin, right? So skin is one. This is represented by this number one, filled with material two. So this is your material, which is shown in gray color, with a thermal conductivity much less than that of the air. And in C, figure C, we have a thick air-filled TEG with a radiator. So as you can see here, the other thermally isolating and shock protecting components are encapsulation wall. Five is here, which is rigid support such as pillars. And six is a thermally isolating protection grid, which allows air convection and being transparent for infrared radiation. This is just for representation purpose. As you can see, temperature map of hand, so also known as Palmer view, the infrared image has been taken here with calibrated radiometric camera. As you can see, the power concentrations are shown on our palm. Normal power concentrations are shown here. So temperature profiles around the wrist with a circumference of 17 centimeter at two ambient temperatures, which is 27 degrees centigrade and 22.3 degree centigrade, are measured in indoor environment and is shown here. So that is shown here in this case. This is another type of thermoelectric energy harvester. So it is using same two hot and cold plates. Between that you have your thermopile, right? And this is designed for placing at wrist. Right. A similar kind of thermoelectric generator is shown in front of you, which is placed on the wrist. Heat flow through the TEG per square centimeter of skin measured indoors on the wrist of 100 people is presented in this graph. And they were sitting still at a mean room temperature of 22.3 degree centigrade. So heat flow was shown in this particular graph. Similarly, in this case, in figure A, estimated thermal resistance per square centimeter of the skin measured at 22.7 plus minus 0.5 degree centigrade on wrist of 77 people under the attached TEG is represents, this is one, represents the resistance between the body core and arterial blood in the wrist. Similarly, this two indicates the thermal resistance between the arterial blood and the TEG device. Now here in the figure B, there are nine locations where the thermal resistance of a human being has been measured. And in C, thermal resistance of a human body at 23 degrees centigrade, depending on its location on the trunk, has been shown. So several studies have been performed by different research groups, particularly Leonov is very peculiar in generation of thermoelectric generators, and he has designed several devices. For example, as you can see in this case, so wrist-based devices are there. In A, the first wrist TEG, according to his claim, is shown here. So one is the electronic module, two is nothing but a hot plate, and third is the radiator, which is placed here. A similar TEG is worn on the wrist next to a watch. In C, what you can see, TEG with a pin-featured radiator. And in D, a waterproof TEG for outdoor use is presented. Then in the case of this figure, E, TEG in the wireless sensor for measuring the power generated by people in real life is presented. And finally, in F, the power produced by the device, which is shown in C, in the office on a sitting circle on a sitting and walking is shown here. So circle is for sitting, and this triangle is for walking person is shown. Okay. I am moving a little faster. Another prototype is wireless pulse oximeter, which is shown here in some figure A, B, and C is the prototype when it is attached to a laptop. Okay. So this is a battery-free device, which is fully self-powered at an output update rate every 15 seconds. And its power consumption is 62 milliwatt, while the TEG typically produces more than 100 milliwatt. About 47% of the power is used for the signal processing. 36% is consumed by two LEDs. 12% is used for a quiescent power, and 5% for the ratio. And we have another important feature is device switches automatically on if there is enough voltage on the supercapacitor, which is part of the device. In case of fully discharged supercapacitor, it starts in about 15 minutes after putting the device on, and the signal processing in the pulse oximeter is performed on board. Therefore, a minimal power is required for the radio transmission. This is a wireless electrocardiography system powered by the body heat is shown in A, and B shows the TEG component. In C is a completed device where thermopile is one, okay, two is a hot plate, and three is a radiator. So this is your three radiator, which is here, okay, that is there. In this particular device, you can see cross-section of the hybrid thermoelectric photovoltaic generator unit, which is used in EEG system. And first one is thermopile, which is shown here, and second one, these are your PV cells. Third is radiator, which is here. Fourth one is a hot plate, and finally fifth is a thermal shunt, which is provided here. Right, two-channel EEG system with a hybrid power supply is shown. So one particular picture is shown for that. Another TEG is shown here that is used in again EEG measurement. Okay. So in this particular paper, which is a different paper which I have taken, thermal properties of humans and power generation is shown, right? So 6.5 mm thin TEG, which is here with a thermopile between two plates, is shown. This is similar to what we had earlier. Three and four are showing two self-powered EEG systems, so brainwave measurement. For that purpose, it has been used. This is used in clothes. So here, two locations are shown. One on the left-hand side where the PVC cell is. So this is your thermoelectric module, and second one is the PVC cell here, right? So this is for ECG system, which is integrated into an office-style shirt. It was done in 2009. Unlike the EEG and SpO2 sensors, it is powered by a secondary battery. So the battery is constantly recharged using the wearer's body heat itself. Power consumption of energy system is close to 0.44 to 0.5 milliwatt, depending on the sample rate. So given the best demonstrated power efficiency of 75% of voltage up converter, the only 0.6 to 0.7 milliwatt are required from the TEG, right? The sample rate is set automatically depending on available power. To be comfortable for the user, this is built on a modular approach. So we will have several modules, and we can integrate them. So on-node processing is important. See, I am moving to the next section because remember, these are just right? These are just generators with their advantages and disadvantages, which we may have, which we can go through them individually because a lot of information available, everything we can't discuss here, right? Individually. Now, other techniques what we can use to minimize power consumption or reduce the energy consumption. So as I discussed in the beginning once, that on-node processing is one area where we can concentrate and where we can have certain kind of energy reduction techniques that may be used. So as you can see here, this biological word is nothing but as human, we have several types of parameters that we can measure with the help of some variable sensor node. So this is nothing but human. This particular unit is nothing but a variable sensor node. And then this is your electronic world, like our smartphones, PC. And so what happens actually on the node itself, we can provide little bit of online signal processing so that we can, for example, if a scenario is any emergency data, if we are able to tap or process on the node itself, then we need not send the data to a remote offline signal processing unit where it will be taking some time to upload, then it will be analyzed, then the alert will come. If we are doing some efficient algorithm processing, devising an algorithm where on-node processing is done properly, then we can alert the wearer immediately if it is used for certain emergency, you can say, scenarios. So variable sensor nodes connect biological world to the electronic world using interfaces and electrodes, which is shown here, right? And online signal processing will help us in realizing next devices that have increased functionality and longer operational lifetime. So what is the goal here? Goal is nothing but to minimize the device volume and maximize the device operating lifetime under the resource constraint environments, which is nothing but we are talking about hardware resources. We have options to design intelligent algorithms. So we should be able to design algorithms in such a way that only useful information is kept and unuseful information is discarded in such a way that it is not going to harm the user, right? So online real-time lightweight signal processing is one method. Then minimization of size and weight of variable node will directly affect the device discreteness as well as comfort to the user. So as we know that SMT devices are available and they are small when compared to batteries. So leaving aside the ASICs applications, devices as well as interfaces, then electrodes, size of the batteries will dominate the overall volume of the sensor node as I had presented earlier. So there are certain performance and power trade-off. Variable algorithms are assessed in terms of the three-way trade-off between performance, cost, and power consumption. System designer will face difficulty in making decisions, whether it is preferable to maximize the performance or to minimize the cost or to minimize the power consumption. So whether we have an algorithm with very low power consumption but comparatively low algorithm performance, so these kind of trade-off we need to just balance. Better choice than a higher power or higher performance algorithm, right? We need to find out. These choices are driven by the application that the variable sensor is to be used in, and there are many design options available. So variable algorithm must span four levels. These levels are human monitoring application design, then signal processing design, performance testing design, and circuit design. So actually, for all these aspects, there is a big work area that is evolving, right? Those things I'm not touching. I have just listed for informing all of you, right? So signal processing, those who are knowing from pattern recognition point of view, they know that we will have input data, then we will do some feature extraction, normalization, and then finally classification, etc. In between, we have several other things like data reduction and all, okay? Or feature extraction, feature reduction, etc. That is also there, right? So one option is compressing all the physiological data, like making a GIF file in real life, which is not load much, right? Then we can have intelligent signal processing instead of using the first case. So this is most current variable algorithm are trying nowadays how to use intelligent signal algorithms. Analysis of the current data will drive the operation of the sensor node. And this uses these steps, which is listed here. So if we are using generic processors, this is used to implement any algorithm using software, for example, MSP430 based node. As an easy to use device people have used in several academic setup. So this is low power. In active mode, the power consumption was 5.5 milliwatt itself. However, expectations are to bring down the power consumption in microwatt. But the details are not available much in literature. One or two details are there, that one of them I have included in the case study. Then we have generic process accelerators, which will improve power performance, feature extraction, as well as classification stages can be implemented with the help of dedicated hardware as well as accelerators. So their internal or inherent features of low power consumption could be utilized. Here, fully hardware electronics and design trends are there, where very low supply voltages, typically between 0.5 to 1 volt range and down to 0.32 volt, are widespread, because it is directly reducing the power consumption, right? And multiple power zones are actually advised. So these are the certain kind of solutions which people are using to minimize or reduce energy, like multiple power zones are created. So they use dynamic voltage scaling, so allow speed scaling, then clock gating, where clock is disconnected to prevent unnecessary switching, and power gating, where entire sections are turned off to reduce leakage currents. Use of simplified topologies instead of conventional architectures are used. Okay, so I'm moving a little bit faster because I'm approaching towards the end of this session. So use of analog signal processing is a powerful method for minimizing the transistor count, thereby consuming less power. So this case study, I'm not taking care as of now. I will just conclude giving the highlight of this case study. There are two case studies. This one is ECG feature extraction, in which actually 23 features were extracted using Pan Tompkins algorithm, and they were able to save 70% of energy. And they use the MIT BIH arrhythmia database, right? So these are the features. 23 features were extracted. This I'm not going into the detail of what is there, right? The profile graph was generated for profiling analysis, and based on this, they tried to analyze the energy consumption. Okay, and finally, they conclude that they were able to reduce the energy consumption here. So, it was reduced by approximately 70% in all sets of experiments that they had performed. So, this is one case study. Another case study is nothing but which uses a particular necklace, which you can see here, right? And in this particular work also, a lot of, you can say, data was collected in different scenarios. I will show quickly and then I'll conclude the talk. So as you can see here, I'll show you here. This one is important for different window sizes of the data and sample rates, the power capturing was done. Right, so this is relationship between window size, sample rate, and power on MSP430 microcontroller unit. Similarly, this one also. Then what happens about the average transmit power for a fixed bandwidth when it was measured for different connection timings? So in millisecond, it is shown. Similarly, when SD card is used instead of transmitting using Bluetooth, this has been compared. And finally, power dissipation when an FFT algorithm is run on the variable node has been presented in this particular study. So the conclusion was, what they were able to conclude is, findings reveal that the largest determinant of power usage in transmission is the connection interval. Then increasing the connection interval of this necklace from 1 second to 2 seconds while maintaining the same bandwidth can reduce the power usage by 52.1%. So this is of, you can say, achievement for them. Furthermore, the performance advantages of offloading the processing, because this necklace is used for swallow detection, right? So that data, if we are using for small window sizes, which is less than 20, and sample rate also less than 16, was not substantial. So above that, it was substantial. That's what they conclude. Energy savings of buffering the data in SD card is also not encouraging. to avoid Bluetooth transmission cost was also evaluated. And it was found that using SD card logging instead of BTLE transmission can increase power requirements by a factor of 30. So it is increasing actually. So Bluetooth connection was more suitable in that case. Lastly, simulation of power demands of a 16-point FFT algorithm was done. Okay. And it shows that high sample rates and processing algorithms used to analyze audio data in the frequency domain make audio based dietary monitoring techniques for variable. So they tried at least. So here audio means when we swallow or when we eat, no, there will be one vibratory sensation that will be tapped as audio because it is put like a necklace. So I didn't go into the detail of that. So this was the second case study. Summary of my talk is like almost 25 years of wearable device development has been over, and it has seen a lot of changes with respect to overall system design till energy harvesting, right? Among the various energy harvesting techniques for wearables, human-powered devices has seen and will continue to see more developments. That means we will have new innovating technologies that are coming into near future. But we need to minimize on-node power consumption. So we need more effort into that direction, not only in the energy harvesting, but we need to do some work in the domain of node design also. Miniaturized power generators further needs to be improved and designed, and more research work is required here. So these are my references. And with that, I thank you. I thank all the organizers for the opportunity. And